Hi, I'm Mary Kay Mitchell, and I'm on the advisory board for Reflecting, Sharing, Learning, a program of the Athens Regional Library System. And we've been doing a variety of interviews with prominent Athens residents, artists, and authors. And today we have a married couple who have separate careers in art, both in art education and in their own particular artwork, but they've also worked very closely together throughout the years and kind of been come to be known as a couple in the Athens art community. We have Claire Clements and Bob Clements. Thank you for talking with us today. We appreciate it. Many people might call Claire a Renaissance woman because she has demonstrated so many diverse talents and roles throughout her entire life. To enumerate just a few, Claire is a wife, a mother, a grandmother, an artist, a university professor, a disability advocate, an art teacher for all ages of people, and an art group facilitator. And she has been active in community fairs of all kinds in Athens for the 46 years that she's lived here. So you've been a real addition to our community.
Thank you, Mary Kay. Yes, I hope to. I like to do good things.
What kind of early family influences and experience did you have that sort of helped engender this love of art and of helping other people so much?
A lot of them. My mother was an artist, and we used to go painting with her in plein air, which we have a plein air group now.
What does that term mean? Because it's plein, spelled P-L-E-I-N, not
right.
Like the plain meaning subtle.
Right.
And
right, outside. In the fresh air,
okay.
As opposed to working in the studio,
okay. And
much as the Impressionists did,
mm-hmm.
And that's what we do. So we go outside and we go to wonderful places. Like one of the most exciting places was to go to the top of the parking deck downtown and look out and paint.
That's a wonderful view from there.
Right.
But I interrupted. You were talking about your mother and your family, other artists in your family, and what did you
yes,
do growing
my mother,
up
related my mother,
to that?
My mother was an artist, and she. I went painting with her, and my sister became a potter, and she also painted. She went to Alfred University for pottery, and my father was a lawyer, and he considered himself the critic of his three women who painted and potted.
And you must have had a lot of volunteer work or kindness kind of inherent in your family for the kind of things both you and your husband and your family have been involved
in. I think that's true. My mother did scouts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my father was a lawyer, and so he worked with many, many diverse populations.
Mm-hmm.
And I became very aware of people's plights. He was the one who began public housing in America, and they wanted him to move to Washington, D.C., but he didn't want to. He wanted to stay in his own hometown, so that's what he did.
Very understandable, but yeah, that shows a great interest in the family,
yes,
and in helping others.
Yes.
So, real brief biography: you end up with 3 degrees in art. What led
True.
You to do that, and what did you actually major in for that?
I went to Carnegie Mellon, and I majored in art and art education. So, I did a bachelor's in art and art education, and a master's in art and art education, and a doctorate in art and art education. So,
kind of a teacher right from
yes,
the get-go.
Yes. I really just wanted to be an artist, but my father was practical and said, you have to be able to support yourself. So I said, well, I'm going to get married. He said, suppose you get divorced. Well, I've never gotten divorced, thank goodness. But I have.
That was an era so like that. My mom said the same thing.
Wanted to
make sure that I got a certificate.
Right.
What's radio? What's journalism?
Right.
Get a certificate in teaching. You know, women were nurses or teachers.
That's right.
Mostly,
that's what they were.
Then.
And I have taught. It's been very good. I taught middle school. I loved it. I taught at the university level. I taught teachers. Went all over the state of Georgia teaching teachers to do art with their students.
You did a little bit different, the volunteer sort of, or, you know, it wasn't volunteer, you were paid, but the it's changed its name several times, Institute on Development.
It's, yeah, Institute
on Human Development and Disability.
Right.
Institute on Human Development and Disability.
Right.
You did a little bit different there.
Right. I wrote grants. I coordinate outreach training and technical assistance for the UAP. It used to be called the University Affiliated Program, which is a nationwide endeavor. Started with John Kennedy, who had a sister with mental retardation. And so it followed the medical model, which was totally fascinating to me. And the outreach training was terrific. We taught taught families to advocate for their person with developmental disabilities. And eventually, I got into writing grants, and so I wrote probably about $750,000, I think, half to three quarters, in grants.
Wow.
It was for people with and without developmental disabilities in the arts.
What was the transition to use art as a resource in helping people with disabilities?
Oh yes. It's something that there is no right or wrong answer, and anybody can do it. And sometimes the kids themselves you give them some art and they just kind of calm down and just do it. There was one boy who, I worked at the Georgia Retardation Center, that's where my office was, and I was also on the faculty at the university at the same time. And one child, he was just impossible on the bus, but we gave him stringing beads and he was happy. And this is a teenager. So it was really dramatic. It really was.
I mean,
sometimes they would come into the room fighting, but they would just calm down. And the other teachers had trouble with them. I never did because I had stuff for them to do.
Well, that's why so many of the arts can be used as therapies for people with a variety of disabilities, not only development disabilities, but other disabilities, mental illnesses.
Yes, that's true. And I belong to the American Association of Artists Therapists. So not art therapy, but artist therapists. And had a lot of interns, and the interns were Bob's students, and they decided to work with me, usually at the Georgia Retardation Center. And so
it just worked together. Counselor too.
Yeah, counselor too, that's true. That's very true. That's true.
All of that. So you did teach many different ages, from younger children to, like you said, teens there. And then I think...
And senior citizens.
I read that you taught senior citizens.
I did. Yes,
I
love
IHPD?
That. That was through the Northeast Georgia Area Planning and Development Commission. And it was a grant that was in the 10-county area. Well, that was at the beginning when I did that. I taught there. But then I wrote a grant. Bob and I wrote a grant together, and it was to teach art and crafts and various kinds of ways to do art. In the Northeast Georgia Area Planning and Development Commission, which was the 10-county area, and the Senior Citizen Center. So we went to the Senior Citizen Centers, and the students carried out drama, dance, physical fitness, creativity. And we wrote a manual, which is still in existence. And some of the programs stayed after we left, and they continued, especially the physical fitness ones, because you really don't need to have a specialist. They could do it themselves. But that was really a good experience. It was wonderful. And the people really loved it. They would come running out. I had my car full of sticks and yarns and stuff, and they would come out and help me unload my...
What do you have for us today, Claire?
Paintings and stuff.
Did you do that in addition to your full-time job?
I did that. That was part of my job, yes. And when I first did it, it was before I'd gone on the faculty at the University of Georgia. At the very beginning, I worked for the Northeast Georgia Planning and Development Commission, just doing an art program that they already had in existence, and I took it over, maintained it.
Yeah. Well, sounds like you were really busy during all those times. And
busy.
Of course, like many of us, raising a family taking care of a lot of different things. So, as I understand it, you weren't doing as much of your own art.
Not as much. But I was a Sea Grant artist just prior to doing my work at the university. And my work is now at the Georgia Museum of Art, and there are five or six large pieces. I did aerial views of the estuaries, and it was the beginning of my cutting. I do a lot of cutting now, and I did my cutting then, and I worked from photographs of the aerial views of the estuaries.
Yeah, because getting a Sea Grant is very prestigious. I mean, it's really, it's hard to get, and they're well known. I mean, it's part of Sea Grant. If people don't know, it can be part of a land grant institution. They have them at various universities around the country, and Georgia has one, but it's maintained nationally, so it's nationally recognized.
And it was the first one to do an art program. Rita Rivers kind of headed that up, and Ed Chin. And I'm not sure if anybody else has done, any other states have done the art program, but it was full of, it was mainly professors at the art department.
Yeah, many of the
department.
Athens area artists have been chosen because of their talent and expertise.
It was really pretty exciting. It was a wonderful thing. Went down to the coast and viewed Rita took us, Bob and I, down there, and we, like it, had a private tour of everywhere, and it was just really nice.
Get your inspiration right at the source.
Right.
And so that was where you got some of the ideas for some of the forms that you've used now that you're retired, and now you've reinvented yourself again as a very prolific artist with a very interesting process.
Thank you.
You want to describe what that process, tell us what you call it?
I will. I call them cut paper paintings, and I paint very loosely, very, very loosely, and then I cut for definition. And this is a small, let's see.
You use what you said, what kind of paints do you use then?
Well, I use water-based paints because that's what I'm really comfortable with using. Mm-hmm. And these are some reason that is, I do things in layers too, and that was to go on another piece.
I might just show people here, like it actually, so it's very three-dimensional. And she's already drawn some things and started to cut.
Right.
Yeah, so there's a big base, and then you use a glue. Right. What kind of glue do you use?
Well, I use, I use 3M spray. Huh. I use spray glues, and they seem to work. I press them overnight on very lots and lots of stuff all piled up on top of them. But I also have some, it's underneath the table, I haven't used it yet, but I'm going to coat some of my work with it so I won't have to put glass over everything because they're large and they become very heavy. So I'm going to do that.
But I've also, what kind of things do you use? Scissors and use an X-Acto knife other drafters
This is one of my X-Acto knives.
This is an X-Acto knife, which many people might know in architects, draftsmen, cartographers, like my husband.
In fact, I got my first injury with one of those. I was about 10 and I was jabbing and I jabbed myself in. I still have a scar on the top of my knee. I always love to cut. But the addition that I've done fairly recently is I put zots underneath them, so it's raised. So there's
what underneath them?
They're called ZOTs. They're like little level.
A little dot.
Yeah, a little dot.
A dot, but called zots to raise it up just a little bit. That adds even more to it being three-dimensional.
Yeah. So that's been fun to do.
It's like, so here's straight edges, but then here's a sculptured or scalloped edge.
Right.
This is beautiful.
This is a lawn, actually, or huge, maybe it was miles and miles of my friend's home in Houston, and that was the sun setting and the various trees and various stuff.
The orange landscape. Is varied, like going into the sunset.
Very big landscape. Nice. It was fun. It was a whole lot of fun. Then I had a billboard, too. This is part of it. Yeah.
You and your husband have been...
Right. We did that.
Very prominent in getting public art.
Public art.
Out, especially in our community. And we'll talk about that some more with Bob. But you got one of the early billboard commissions. And there were only, how many were there?
Well, that first year, I think there were five or six. Uh-huh. Maybe something like that. And then the next year, Bob got his. And there were a number that year, too.
Yeah. So, and what's the name of this one?
This was Songbirds in the Hosta Forest. And I did a lot of cutting. It was very loose. You can see the painting underneath. But then I just kind of let myself go and cut however I wanted to cut. And that freedom was important. Mm-hmm. And I made it also into a skateboard. They were doing a skateboard for the skateboard park. And I put this image on a skateboard.
Oh, wow.
And it looked like it was carved in. And it was it had a lot of varnish on it. So it looked like it was carved. And Dee Dee asked me, was it carved? Well, it was glued on.
Did you have to take into consideration it was going to be blown out?
No, I didn't think about it. No, they wanted the work, and I just sent in what I had. I didn't even consider that at all.
So most of your inspiration does seem to be in nature.
It is. It truly is. I lived on a lake when I grew up. Uh-huh. And I
What lake? Was it a smaller one?
It was a small lake, and it had been a reservoir, and I lived in Eastchester, New York. Uh-huh. And I lived in one of the first apartments. It was an apartment that was a garden type apartment. It was one of the first ones that ever was. And it was right on a lake. And we went across the street and swam and fished and boated. And there were woods, and we played in the woods. And it was just wonderful.
That's why it seems like so many of your colors are, as I see them, seem like they're out in nature. A lot of sort of jewel and brighter colors.
Yes. And that's important for a work of art to have that contrast, mm-hmm. the light and dark, mm-hmm. and I try to do that to give a.
But they seem like real colors, and like there's a real richness to
good.
Them, you know. And at least that's the feeling I get. I mean, good. Behind us, we can see there's a picture right here that has some of those really bright colors. Tell us about that one.
Yeah, that was it was inspired by a bouquet that was brought to us by some guests. And they were those Asian lilies, which are just gorgeous. And we've had some Asian lilies. They didn't bloom this year, but they've bloomed in the past. And so those, yeah, I have to really love what I'm going to do, what I'm going to paint. Uh-huh. And if I don't love it, I can't do it. So I have to really have feeling for it. So it takes a while. So I knew about the Asian lilies, and I thought it was beautiful. So I tried to do the tissue paper and the lilies. And I love suns and moons and circles. And the circles kind of balance out the curvilinear thing, so I put the circles behind it. And
then so just that's even more multimedia adding. If you yep, use right. tissue paper that's in there true. Stuff. And it's, I don't know if this will come out on the video, but it's shining quite a bit in the light. It has true. A different texture.
There. Right. Yeah, actually, I made the tissue out of chalk, so it's not actual tissue. I tried to, but that was significant for me because that was hard. It was hard to make
one,
it look.
Yeah, and this won first prize?
Yes, it did. It won first prize at Linden House. I was surprise
and
exhibit thrilled.
Was that?
It was the Garden Club, the Women's Garden Club.
What year was that?
That was about 3 months ago.
3 months ago, so 2015 we're talking
right,
about
right.
here.
Yes.
And transitioning then the bright colors, and this must be something that looks like it might be a little more either at dusk or dawn.
Yes, it was.
With some little evening. Darker colors?
Yes, and the true, and they work well for contrast, and that was a soybean field, and I painted it, you can see, very, very loosely, and the idea of looking through and seeing, it's like a net across the surface, and looking through to the distance, so you have up close and far away, and I think it's probably one of my best pieces.
Yeah.
I was happy about that piece.
Yeah,
you never know how they're going to come
it,
out.
Was it exhibited somewhere?
Yes, it was. And, let's see, I'm in a number of places.
Mm-hmm. Okay. traveling.
I think in OCAF. They were around. In OCAF because it was in one of their postcards.
And
yes.
OCAF is the Oconee OCAF. County Arts Foundation,
right.
which is very active, just like the Athens Area Art Council, which I know you've been active right. with as well.
Right.
And
right.
people can see, too, we have four panels behind us that are very large. And tell us about those.
Yes, I'd be happy to. If you could hand me that little postcard that's under there. Mm-hmm. These are G. Clay prints, and the G. Clay prints are made out of inks that will last about 100 years.
Wow.
They're very permanent, and they're very lovely colors. These were blown up. They're blown up from this piece. I had a one-person show at OCAF, and it was called Paper Moon was what I called it, because I had a lot of moons in it. Mm-hmm. But anyway, sections of this were blown up, and they were on exhibit at Athens Ford, which was Ithaca's first off-site exhibition space.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, as you came in to Athens Ford, there were these very large, this very large wall up very high, and that's where these were for almost a year. And they looked great there. They really did.
I can imagine.
They really look great.
One other thing I noted about these, about much of your work, is there aren't a lot of different colors in each one. You seem to be a little
true.
More limited, and I wondered, but it's gorgeous. It really highlights the colors that are in there. Had you noticed that? Is there an intent to that?
Well, I didn't really realize it until somebody mentioned, I didn't know what a colorist you were. Yes, I am a colorist. and I try to give my work a point of view, which is something that I learned at Carnegie Mellon from mm-hmm. Roger Anlike, who was a marvelous teacher. And I tried to give some most, less, and least amount of things so that it's not too much of everything all mixed, so it mm-hmm. has punch. And that's what I tried to do, give it that punch. Yeah.
Your philosophy.
Yeah, it is. It truly is. When I see something that's a big hodgepodge of colors, I don't know which to look at first. So I just try to make it be logical, and so that it satisfies some of my own sensibilities, because when I look at the thing, I say yes, no, and I put many, many things together before I came to that
mm-hmm.
conclusion. I try a lot of things, a whole
so
lot of
sometimes
things.
Like in this process, you're
You sort of draft, they're different drafts, like an author might have different drafts and revisions?
Yes, and I use everything that I do. I make sketches, and I make drawings and paintings, and I don't throw them away. I use them. I recycle them, so to speak, and so they all kind of add up, and they make unusual combinations too. But they're all from me, so they're all okay. Yeah.
And we see here mostly from nature, but you do have some that have. What I've seen is some that have really beautiful sort of silhouettes in like a off-white that almost look a little bit kind of ghostly of people.
That's true. They are.
But I also understand you do a lot with that have faces, but they sell up quickly, so we might not see
them. That's true. I have one that's behind us. I don't think we can get it's behind there, but it's a couple of large silhouettes of people. Mm-hmm. And somebody said to me, is that a portrait, a self-portrait? No, it just comes out of me. I just do it and I don't even think about most of it, things like that. Unless I'm using the model, which there are a couple of my in-process pieces. This was the model and it has a person in it.
Right here.
Right. And
but it seems like the people are coming out very organically, or like I said, silhouettes that are kind of behind it. And
let's see this piece.
You can see that.
This is also the model. She had on a necklace. It was an incredible necklace, and it was plastic and gorgeous. It was white and it had like claws. And I asked her if I could buy it from her. She said, "No, it has special meaning to me." So I said, "I'm going to pay you first. You go home and take photographs of it." So she did, and so I haven't used them yet, but I'm going to use them some more. It was very motivating to me. And before that, we had lots and lots of daffodils, and these were my daffodils. So then I brought my paper with the daffodils to the model when we were. I brought that with me over to OCAF when we were doing the model.
Ah. That's how that happens. So you actually have people sit and pose for the ones where you include people.
Yeah, most of them, not all of them, most of them. Mm-hmm. Let's see, I have another, I don't know where it is, but where I put it.
But the one thing I know, and like I said, they sort of like really are very organic with the natural elements. It seems to me that there was one that I noticed that had the title Unity. It was on the Unitarian Universalist website.
Yes.
Had the circles again and things together. It seems like that's a theme for many of your pictures of unity, especially the ones with people and nature.
That's very true. And I like to bridge the gap between the real and the cerebral. I think I don't really like to do realism, but I like it to be more symbolic. So what the natural means and what you think about it, I try to put those together. And so one of the people over at Linden House said, "Well, this is the way you would like it to be." When they saw some of my works, I thought that was pretty good.
That's a wonderful observation.
It was. It was Tony Carlucci.
You know a lot of the flowers and nature because you have you're into gardening,
right?
And you have a garden and wonderful nature around your own home.
That's true.
Well.
And you develop feelings for the flowers.
Really?
It's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
As I say, I really have to love what I'm doing, what I'm decided to do, and that comes with just every year seeing those same flowers come up, and they just become dear to me. Sounds silly, but they do. They become dear to me.
I mean,
and
it's a wonderful,
it's meaningful.
It's a wonderful respect for the natural world.
I try to. And there's one over there that is a yellow flower that we have. This looks like popcorn. And then I brought it over and did the models on top of that one too. So that's bridges the gap. And then in the living room is another painting that you were talking about, Unity, and that's the actual painting itself, or the one that was in the Unitarian world.
Any other future directions? New things associated with this?
Yes, I have a lot of things that are in process now, and I work on about four or five things at once. What speaks to me that day is what I work on, or that hour, and I'll switch to different things when I just for variety or whatever, or something doesn't work, so I go somewhere else and work on a different, not somewhere else, but someplace else in the studio, work on a different piece. And they take a long time for me because I consider and I think about them. I let my subconscious work on them. I try to put them up on the wall or now on boards. It seems to work better to work on boards. and then stand them up around. So
it seems like you still have a lot of ideas still coming that you're going to be working.
Thank you. I hope so.
All the time.
I hope so.
Thank you so much for speaking
to
us today.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you. I appreciate it from you. Thank you, Mary Kay. Nice to see you again.
Yes.
Thank you.
Bob Clements is definitely what you would call a man for all seasons. He is an internationally recognized artist and sculptor, an award-winning university professor, very prolific grant writer, and a mentor to many other artists. Bob has spent 46 years in Athens, but his interest in art began at his family home at a very, very young age. He apparently remembers this, so I'd like to hear your story.
When I was 2 years old, my mother, who was a teacher and artistic herself, I drew a row of ducks, quack, quack, duckies. And she thought it was pretty darn good. And it was darn good. It's more like a seven-year-old would do. So she got me a little maple table to draw at. And I loved that. And I never had any problem knowing what I wanted to be in life.
I don't think I've ever heard anyone who knew what they wanted to be starting at age two. That is marvelous. And there she goes. You were just set from then on. So I guess it wasn't any big decision to get your degrees in art. And what did you study when you were actually in school?
I studied painting and drawing. Mm-hmm. Painting and design at Carnegie Mellon. Mm-hmm. And then I was dating Claire my senior year, and she was in art education. I thought, well, that's a good idea. There are jobs.
Right, right.
Art education.
How do people in the creative fields find jobs? Education, yeah. Well, you went on to be a very successful teacher. You both taught first at Ball State University in Indiana. Were you teaching the same things, or what were you teaching?
I was teaching art appreciation then. Mm-hmm. And then when we came to Georgia, I taught art appreciation and art education. And
painting and drawing?
Graduate art education.
Okay, yeah. So what do you think is inside of you or your experiences in life that made you so prolific and so successful in grant writing? I mean, that's a very hard field, and you got lots of public and private commissions from your different grants. Yes. You received a lot of money and commissions. What makes you successful at that?
I guess just being able to put myself in the other person's shoes. We would often, the grants would all have RFPs, requests for proposals, that would be filled with the buzzword that you were supposed to comply with. And so I was a pretty compliant person.
You learn what worked. And what didn't.
That's right.
But it's a lot of attention to detail, too.
Oh, yeah, a lot of attention
in
to detail.
In those forms and things, you really have to hone in on that.
In my teaching, I taught art appreciation. I had the best job in the world. We used slides at that time. Now it's all PowerPoints.
Ah.
But at that time, we went to this big slide room that had millions of slides in it, and we would hold them up to the light and pick out the
one at a time
or so slides to talk about that day.
Did you ever take your students to museums to look at the art and its setting?
I had the classes of 125.
Ah.
It wasn't feasible. With my smaller classes, I did. We would go there.
Yeah, because the Georgia Museum of Art was much smaller, a smaller building than people know it nowadays in 2015. But when you came and I came, it was in the smaller building where the president's office is now on North Campus.
Yes.
So they had a lot stored away.
Indeed.
It's pretty small. And then
Indeed.
They built the larger building, and now they've expanded.
Wonderful museum.
Isn't it great that art has become so much more prominent
it's wonderful.
Athens at the university? So you're also prolific in writing, 3 or 4 books and 60-some articles. What did you write about?
I wrote about art education, and I worked with Frank Wachowiak, who was a famous art educator. And when he got old, he turned his book over to me. He did the first four editions, and I did the next four or five editions.
So is it used like as a textbook?
It is a textbook.
A textbook,
it's
primarily?
Still being used, yes.
And were most of your articles about that too?
About how to teach art, different aspects of teaching art.
That's wonderful, teaching the next generation, not only, you know, passing on your knowledge.
Yes, and I loved working with graduate students at the university and helping them write their master's thesis and doctoral dissertations.
So were you able to do any of your own art during that time,
oh,
too,
yes,
before you retired?
Time,
the whole time?
Oh, yes.
And you were fortunate. It looks like you retired after only about 25 years or so.
That's true.
Pretty,
it's true.
Pretty young guy that had to set out into full-time, working on art full-time.
I always worked on my art.
Yeah, yeah. But you decided you could live on that, huh? Working full-time after retirement,
yes.
on your art.
Yes.
So is that when you branched out? I know some of your early work, and you continue to do a lot of painting. And a lot of landscapes. We have some behind us that we can talk about. Is that what your early interest was in? Some
My
of the outdoors and painting?
In graduate school, I turned from painting to sculpture.
So you started that early with the sculpture?
Very early.
Okay.
So I was doing sculpture for...
All the way along?
All the way along.
Okay. So it was a dual interest there.
I was with a wonderful gallery in Atlanta, Fay Gold Gallery, mm-hmm. and sold a lot of sculptures through
wow.
the gallery.
Did you start small and then get large like
no,
you are now?
I started with 8-foot-high sculptures, and I'm still,
right
still
off,
doing them.
It's right off the bat.
I have several downstairs.
So was there a place at the university, when you were at the University of Georgia, where you could do those large sculptures?
No, I always worked at home.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Well, no, at the beginning when I came to Georgia, mm-hmm. I had a studio in Lucy Cobb Institute.
Oh.
But that didn't work because I would teach all day long. I would come home and gobble my supper, and then I would go off to the studio, and Claire didn't like that.
So your wife wanted you around the house.
Oh,
wow.
So
yeah,
I moved my studio home, where it's been ever since. And it's worked very well.
So you must be very good in welding. is that what kind of, you know, I mean, for people who don't know, then many of your sculptures, I don't know if you could see it very well on the computer here, but they're large, they're made of metals. What kind of metals and welding and other tools do you use to create these large sculptures?
I used a computer to mm-hmm. create this sculpture.
Okay.
And then I made a model. So for this sculpture in front of the library, it's big, gigantic thing, 15 feet tall.
For people who don't know, Bob got the commission for public art right in front of the Athens-Clarke County Library building, part of the regional library system.
Especially sweet for me because I fought very hard for a public art program in for Athens.
Correct.
Attended public hearings and...
You were the driving force behind the initiative now that
yes.
That not only allows, but I mean that actually tries to get public art. There's
yes.
Isn't there so many per year now, or so many per funding cycle that they
yes.
try to put
and
out?
A certain percentage of
that's
new,
it.
Of new construction.
Shin has to include public art. I think Athens is becoming one of the leading cities in that respect.
It's moving along. And this sculpture has, on the computer, this very computer, I designed it, the mother reading a book as she brings back her books to the library with her little tyke in hand, bringing back his books or her books. And there's a middle school just up the street where they do wheelies and acrobatics. You know, like teenagers.
Active, very active.
Active. So
yeah, preteens and teens.
He's reading his book as he's doing a
flip. Cartwheel.
And then there's an allegorical figure up at the top of a muse, the muse of learning. And she has a laptop in her hand. And so she's pointing to the library in back. And in back there are book birds.
A new species. It's amazing how you combine so many different thoughts and the idea that even though we started with paper books, you can get learning and knowledge as well from the laptop.
Gosh, isn't it thrilling?
Yeah.
Amazing.
But there's a place for all of them. There's still a place for
That's right. Some people still
paper
read
books.
Books.
I do. A lot. Well, I was a library person. My mother, when I was like a late teenager, bought a book. And I brought it home. I was so excited because I bought a book with my own money, you know, that I had made. And she said, "Why did you buy that?" I said, "What do you mean?" She says, "You just go to the library." And actually, you know, to this day, I go to the library more than I buy books, because my mother was always, you know, taught me you go to the library to get your books. They're for
my
free there.
Book, my parents took me to Pittsburgh, and bought me a book. It was a $10 or $12 book on how to do cartooning. And I learned how to draw Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck and all those people. I was just in seventh heaven, drawing from that book on how to draw.
Draw, there you go, starting again.
The power of books, may I say.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I had plenty because they were at the library.
That's right.
Yeah, I'm still at the library. I can't get away from the library, but like you can't get away from art. Yeah, exactly. And so you have a lot of other commissions for a lot of your sculptures, too. Where are some of the other prominent ones that we might have? Yeah, that's why I say all across the country and some even in other countries.
Yes, yes. There's one in, several in Atlanta and one in California. Beautiful red sculpture. And in Atlanta recently, I did one at a park in Atlanta, Isabel Gates Webster Park. She was a fighter for civil rights. She came to Georgia with Martin Luther King. He told her to go to Georgia and Atlanta and fight for civil rights, and she did that. She became a judge, and I did the sculpture in her memory.
Mm-hmm.
And my buddy and I, Harold Rittenberry, often work together on many public sculptures.
Mm-hmm. And I read that you help him with the grant writing, though, when you're going to do it. You're the grant writer.
I'm the grant writer.
So you're responsible for actually getting Harold Rittenberry, a lot of his work, out to the public as well.
True, but he has enormous talent.
Of course he does, but you help
a facilitator,
mentor.
Yes, indeed.
And that kind of thing.
Absolutely.
One thing I noticed, this has the figures, sculpture in front of the Athens-Clarke County Library. Most of them are grounded. There are many that you have, including the ones in Atlanta, that are very tall and towers and have leaping figures. That's one of your signature sculpture ingredients, the leaping figures.
That's right.
And I want to know, what was the inspiration for that? And why you continue to do it a lot?
Well, the leaping figures are full of energy, like ballet dancers leaping. Mm-hmm. And this is a motif. The figures are not quite leaping, but this is, it relates to Claire and I, and she's holding me up on this galloping horse. And I've done several of those. But the figure is almost flying.
Yeah. So in essence, what? The leaping figure, it's the energy? Is it showing
energy.
Your energy and your wife's energy?
Yes, yes.
Really?
Yeah, as we speed through life.
Well, because for many years there was one on top of a hill off East Campus Drive at the University of Georgia, the hill where now is the Ethnobotanical Garden.
Yes.
And I told you over the phone earlier that it is one of my most favorite pieces of sculpture ever, because when I'd be driving down that road, and you know it's a busy road, it can sometimes be frustrating, lots of traffic, you know, or you're going back and forth to different places at work, and I used to see that and it just made me feel so joyful. and so happy. These people, it wasn't like they were fleeing a building. They were kind of, you know, there was a building look, but that they were leaping and jumping for joy. And
jumping
it just,
for joy.
Yeah.
Going out in the world.
Yeah, and I always felt very happy when I saw that. So, I mean, that's a great tribute to your sculpture, that it seems to draw great
Thank
emotions
you.
From people, I think.
Thank you. The idea of outreach and going out and as you have done in your career in radio and going out to the whole public at large.
Yeah, see what they're doing. Well, so you mentioned that you do create on the computer the initial images and models. So are you saying that you don't actually do the fabrication then? You get fabricators to do it or to help you do it?
I had a 3E fabrication in Arnoldsville build this all, but for the past 30 years, I've done my own fabrication.
Okay, so you do.
And I'm still doing my own fabrication.
Okay.
Cutting. But
so you do cut and weld, or do you do welding tools?
Cut and weld.
Okay,
yes.
And what do you use then? Yeah, the welding tool to cut, or are there saws? Or
plasma arc cutter.
Wow. You have to be careful with that.
Everything is dangerous. It's bad on the eyes, it's bad on the nose, and it's bad on the hands and ears. nothing nice about it at all.
But you still do it. So it's giving you something back, obviously.
That's
and
right.
Giving the rest of the world something.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
When I retired, I turned to painting, to do more paintings. And we go to Oconee Cultural Arts Foundation. Every Tuesday night, and they have models, and we draw the models. These are two, it's really one model, drawn twice. Sewing sisters, they're sewing. She has a thimble, she has a needle threader, and they're doing some sort of embroidery.
Well, you know what's funny about this, because I went just before this, a couple days before this interview, I went over to the Oconee County Arts Foundation studio. They had just, were closing this exhibit that they had over there for OCAF members. And there was this beautiful piece you had there where the background was gray that looked like chalkboard. And you had a beautiful woman sitting there with a lot of these lighter white touches and some yellow on it. And it looked like chalk, but I don't think it was.
It might have been chalk. I have forgotten what I put in that show.
Well, it was, yeah, I'm sorry I don't recall the name, but it was a beautiful woman, and it looked very, very different, obviously, than many of your pieces. I think a lot of people might know you better besides a sculpture for some of the landscapes that you've done
this
through the years.
This is a billboard.
This is with your billboard commission
billboard
from Athens-Clarke County as well.
Claire had her billboard, and it looked great. It was like driving down the highway and seeing this big, beautiful field of canola, which is such a striking yellow, just a total
really
field of yellow.
So what's interesting is that you are trying so many different styles. You're still using and experimenting with new media all the time.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
So you've done painting, you do metal sculpture. This looks like it's made of, what, clay, a paper mache?
Aluminum.
Aluminum, so it's another metal one.
Aluminum metal.
Okay.
This is out at Nakanishi, across the street from Nakanishi and the middle school out there.
Are there other types of media you want to explore in the future?
Perhaps. I don't know. We'll have to see.
You never know what the future will hold, huh?
No. I used to do wood sculpture.
Uh-huh.
But then I got into metal sculpture, because with metal you could put them outside, whereas wood, it had to be indoors.
It could last longer.
And last longer with metal.
Well, one of the newest pieces you have is called Entrance Totems, and they're, what, 9 feet? Tall,
oh,
and the series of faces made of that. What's that, stainless steel?
Stainless steel.
Would
yes.
be remarkable in front of any kind of institution
yes.
or building.
Yes.
And do you have a commission for that, or you did that
no,
just because it was something
just
inspired
something
you?
I liked it.
Yeah.
And my son titles my sculptures and paintings for me. So we can now call that Tribes of Discourse.
Oh. Okay. Well, I noticed it's a series of faces, and it's they start with they're facing each other, and then the next one they're away, and they're facing away. Yes. As well, is that what the discourse is?
That's right, back and forth in a conversation.
Is it supposed to be a good dialogue rather than an angry discourse?
Not an angry dialogue.
Okay, well, that's good. That's good. We need more of that, don't we? But so are you going to be looking for a buyer or commission like that?
I'm also working on a bench, my first bench. My buddy Harold has done many, many benches, but this is my first bench. And he told me I should make a bench, so I'm following in his footsteps.
What are you going to make the bench out of?
Stainless steel. Uh-huh. In fact, he and I went to Atlanta to a junkyard and bought the stainless steel. And
ready to start on it. Does
he's working on many sculptures now.
Do you work at each other's studios with each other?
No. Totally separate, but we encourage each other.
Okay. That's a good symbiotic relationship, I find that many artists are like that, that they're very supportive of each other and they really inform each other.
Claire and I work quite closely. We often paint side by side out in nature. And we give each other crits on each other's painting of what's wrong with this painting.
Does crit make it, the term make it softer than a critique?
Well, we're a critique.
Yeah.
And she tells me what bothers her about it.
At least it comes from someone you know where it's coming from, a place of the heart and not just somebody trying to disrespect something, you know, find flaws in it.
Yeah, because the art has the public, there's always the public face and how it relates to other people.
So you need to know.
You need to get some feedback, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for talking with us. We really appreciate
it. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Faye.
So you both do different things. Right now, Claire is doing cut paper paintings as her primary focus. Bob is still working on large metal sculptures and smaller sculptures and paintings, and we think chalk on one of his recent paintings. But what brings you together? What part of art do you still do together? How do you interact in creating your art?
Well, we have a plein air group. I started the plein air group about 18, 19 years ago. It meets once a month, and it's nobody teaches and nobody pays anything. We just all do work together. So it brings, and then we work for a few hours, we put the work out, we just encourage each other, and then we go eat somewhere. So it's a social thing, and it brings us all together.
It's very motivating to me. It got me doing artwork again.
From the sculptures, you mean?
Yes, yeah. And we also do plein air. We do figure drawing at the Pony Cultural Arts Foundation.
Oh, and that you were saying that there's a night, you know, once a week or something, there's models.
Tuesdays, 5:30 till 8:30. Costs $10.
We all chip in, so it's open to everybody.
So have you done much? Neither one of you has done that much of kind of representational, realistic figures or portraits. You've started. He does it, but you are starting to within yours. But you've also done some silhouettes and more symbolic sort of figures. Is that helping you in another new area of art?
Oh yes. It's quite stimulating.
So you're always learning.
Lots of challenges.
Never stagnant.
Oh, the scariness of the blank canvas. What are you going to do on it?
But it seems like you have plenty of ideas of your own in your own artwork and creative process.
Right.
Always. I mean, you're working on, Claire works on four or five different ones at once. And how about you, Bob? Do you have several in
I
process?
I have several in process.
All the time?
I have one right back here of a couple. That's Claire and I dancing on the back of an iguana.
Ah. Where did you do that? Costa Rica or Central America?
Just like that's a metaphor for life.
It's sounds like you also have, like, you know, do you work together, like, you know, side by side, even though you do different work, and how do you inform each other's work?
Well, we've always shared a studio, and we started sharing a studio when we were graduate students. We were married, we were at Penn State, we had been at Carnegie Mellon, and we married after Carnegie Mellon and went to Penn State and shared a studio in a very old house, remember?
We would ride our bicycles through the snow and skidding and slipping and falling into snow banks.
That's wow. Dedication to your
dedicated.
Art.
We'd leave at midnight.
We had no phone, no car.
The good old days. The good old days. Right. You also then went to Ball State University, taught there. And then you were both here at the had various positions at the University of Georgia. Was it difficult for the two of you to get positions at the same universities in the same town?
It sure was.
How did you do it at Ball State? There's somebody
we
that
were,
went
we
first.
We were hired together. We were a two-person package at Ball State. But here was
Nepotism laws.
So you went, is that what inspired you to sort of go in a tangential way and work for the...
Yeah. I worked for in-service for a long time. Then I worked for the UAP in disabilities, developmental disabilities. Yes, I focused on art in many of those. I did.
And you also said you did the worked with the Northeast Georgia
Planning.
So you had, so Bob was hired for at the university and you had to make your way like many others.
I had to make her way. She taught art at senior citizen centers, and they loved it.
I did things that nobody else could
She went all over the state teaching 30 or so classes at Fort Valley and Dalton. And
all over.
After school classes.
50 classes.
Many,
each one met 11 times. What?
Many classes here in this area to teachers, teaching art to teachers.
Wow.
And they loved it.
It was really fun. I loved it too. Really fun.
So when you're in a studio and you're maybe both working on stuff, do you ever talk to each other about your art?
Claire says I can't hum and whistle. I have to be quiet.
You can stay in my studio if you don't hum. You're happy when you hum, but you can't hum.
Do you have input on each other's work since you work in very different media? Well, somewhat maybe different.
I always ask Claire what she thinks, what it needs. She tells me what it needs.
Yeah, and I ask you too.
Oh, yes.
But I don't listen very well. But I ask. We give minimal input, I think. We really don't work together on things. Uh-huh. We do. We have a couple of times, but it's really...
Does it help, like, give, like, the perspective of, you know, obviously art is for other people to see, and so that you know, even though you're creating it from inside yourself with your own heart and soul, it's helpful to know what other people might be seeing or what, you know, how they might perceive it.
Oh yes. Sometimes the creator is blind to whether the head is too big or the hand is too big. Or
it's a perspective.
It's
and
ugly. Yeah.
Proportion.
Right. That's right.
And yeah, we try to help each other.
And you've been very active in the whole arts community in Athens-Clarke.
Oh, yes.
You've written grants and mentored other artists. I believe you're busy with the council and starting other groups.
I have been in the past with the Arts Council, and so has Bob. But I buy artwork from other artists. I don't trade, I buy them. I pay for them in legal tender. Like, everybody should be paid, because most artists aren't, you know, don't sell. Seems like that anyway.
It's hard to make a living as just a working artist,
right.
Say, as a painter, drawer, just a sculptor. It seems like you need other outlets too.
Yes, and we made our living as educators, as teachers, and we still do function as a nurturing, trying to nurture other people.
Pass it down, pay it forward.
You can't pay it always
directly back to somebody who helped you. You help someone else.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yes, and we have this collection
of other artists' work.
Artists, yes.
That's very useful because in interviewing artists, one of the things that I found sometimes They say that people expect artists to donate their work for all these benefits and for all these charities, and they don't, you know, I mean, they do ask businesses for cash donations, but cash-strapped artists can't always donate their work, you know, if they're trying to make a living.
So they ask them for artwork.
Yeah, so they ask them for artwork, and it still takes a lot of their time. So it's good that you have this idea of paying cash even as another artist, swapping or donating. Anything else you want to add? I know you were both in education a long time, and Bob, you know, worked about 25 years here at the UGA, but you also worked at Ball State and Penn State, so you were a teacher for a long time before you retired.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but then did art full-time, must have been a great transition? What do you think?
A lovely transition.
Lovely time.
That's all we do. That's all we do. That's all we know how to do.
You get up in the morning and start working under ideal conditions.
And may it continue for a long time.
For a long time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for talking with us.
Thank you very much.